smart at the time. You worked in technical job. There was nothing honorable about the hotel business. I'd never been in a hotel, and we didn't have a hotel in our village. So, but I begged my parents. I begged them. So finally, they found a job in the best hotel in the region. That was unfortunately 100 kilometers away, but it was the best hotel in the region. Before I got there, my parents told me we could never go to a hotel like that. That is only for very important ladies and gentlemen, not for us. And so behave yourself accordingly. Wash your underwear and your socks and all that stuff, and mother would tell you. And as she took me there, and when I got there, the general manager welcomed us and told us, all the guests that are here are very important guests. And he told me the first day, mind you, I was a busboy, which meant we washed dishes, cleaned ashtrays, cleaned the floor, everything. That's what that meant. But the first day he told us, now, from now on, when you come here, don't come to work. Come to create excellence in what you're doing. And I went over my head at the time. Just, excellence in cleaning ashtrays and ashtray wash. Okay, I will do them as well as I can, was kind of the thought. But he kept on repeating that. And he was a person of excellence. When he walked into the room of the restaurant, he was perfect. On Mondays and Wednesdays, we went to hotel school. The whole region, the kids that worked in hotels and restaurants in the whole region went to this school. And after 2 years going to school, I was about 16, we were asked to write a story, what we now think about the hotel business, hotel restaurant business. What, now that you're 2 years in it, what do you think? And I went to work again, and I noticed that evening the maitre d' was approaching a table, and the guest on the table, those very important ladies and gentlemen, mind you, the guest, they were proud that he came to their table. And I realized this is true. Generally, the guest in this room always think he's the most important person. So did we, the employees. So contemplating that, I wrote the essay, and I named it, We Are Ladies and Gentlemen. If we create excellence in what we're doing, no matter what, you can define yourself as a person of excellence. That I came to that realization there. I wrote an essay about it. We are ladies and gentlemen, serving ladies and gentlemen. Unless we sentence ourselves to be servants by not doing, creating excellence in what we're doing. It stood with me, and when I started Ritz-Carlton, I made it the motto of our company. We are ladies and gentlemen, serving ladies and gentlemen. They're not employees, they're ladies and gentlemen. Every employee is a lady or a gentleman, very simply. In fact, when I opened hotels, I opened every Ritz-Carlton, the first 55 Ritz-Carltons. I opened them, I went there for the orientation of the new employees. They're sitting in a room like this group here, sometimes up to 800 in the room. And when I went in the room, I always said, my name is Horst Schulze, I'm CEO, president of this company, I'm very important. And they look at me with shock. But I told them, but so are you. As human beings, nobody can claim importance over the next human being. We have to know that. As a leader, I know that. You are as important as I am as a human being. Only an idiot would think they're more important as a human being. You are very important, each one of you. I told the employees, as far as the job is concerned, if you don't come to work the day we open the hotel, and we don't wash dishes, and we don't make beds, and we don't cook, and we don't check in, we have a disaster. Your job is very important here. If I don't come to work, nobody will even know. That was a fact. So I learned this from this Methodian. He was with me. He accompanied me throughout my life. And sometimes when I just went to work, and I did it, I apologized to him. I said, I went to work and not to create excellence. So I came to the United States. I worked in the finest hotels in Europe, came to the United States with the intent to be here a year or two. got involved in career, finally ended up, worked with Hilton, and ended up with Hyatt, opening the Hyatt Regency that is very close by here in 1974 as director of food and beverage operation, which I was done. So I became, 2 years later, I became director of rooms. 2 years later, I was general manager in the Hyatt in Pittsburgh. 2 years later, I was general manager in the Hyatt Regency in Detroit and Dearborn. 2 years later, I was vice president for 10 hotels. And then 2 years later, I came back to Chicago to be vice president of food and beverage operations for the United States for 65 hotels. And it was great. It was a great company to work for. When somebody called me 2 years later, 2-3 years later, and said, we are starting a new hotel company in Atlanta. We have two hotels in construction. We are developers and financial people. We need somebody to run the operations of that new company. I said, I have no interest. I had golden handcuffs. I have everything I wanted. I work for a great company in a great city that I really love, Chicago, and no interest. But they called me again, and they called me again. And I said, finally I said, please don't call me anymore. This is, I'm not going to do it. That's it. And they were pushed by other people to go after me at the time. And my wife, I put that on, I just tell you the facts here. By the way, if somebody doesn't agree with me, if anything I tell you, if you don't agree with me, since I give you facts, you're going to be wrong, okay? So obviously, if I give you facts, I would just tell you, put facts in that. My wife was praying heavy that one door would, because she noticed that I said, if I would take this, because they told me I could do operationally what I want. If I would take this, I thought that I have no interest to go to Atlanta, but if I would take it, this would be an opportunity to build the finest hotel company in the world. And I, that's what I would do, and here's what I would do. And she noticed that I was kind of contemplating, playing with the thought. And so she prayed, and then a door closed, and this door was open, and I moved to Atlanta in January 1983. A year later, we opened our festival. I went there with a dream, a vision, a purpose. Aristotle said, people can only be fulfilled if they have purpose and belong. In fact, the Bible, I'm not pushing, here comes a praying in the Bible, please. The Bible says, you will perish without purpose. Every analyst said, you need purpose in life. And I had a purpose, I had a dream to create the finest hotel company in the world. I moved to Atlanta and hired people. I didn't hire people anymore, I started selecting. Because I knew just hiring people, I wouldn't have people. I needed people to join my purpose. I invite them, here's what I want to do. Either you join me in this dream, don't come to work here. Come to join me in a dream. Purpose. If I know that purpose is so important, from any study has been done, that it is the real fulfilling in your life, why wouldn't I give purpose to anybody that joins me? And I realized, and I had made an analysis of what is leadership. And I came up, this is not scientific, this was my study. I came up with 65 general managers we have, and I determined that there are 5 leaders and 60 managers. Leaders that had a purpose for their life and a purpose for their employees. So I established, when I started there, let's sit down and develop the purpose of this company. That's the first thing we did. The first people that I hired that said, yeah, I want to be the part of creating the best thing in the world. And let's sit down, what is really the purpose? Yes, this is our purpose. And then we said, is this purpose good for all concerned as we grow? And if we are the best company in the world, is the purpose of accomplishment good for all concerned? Is it good for us? Is it good for the investors? Is it good for the employees? Is it good for the guests? Is it good for society as a whole? And the answer was an unequivocal yes. This would serve them all. Now, if as a leader I have established a purpose that serves all, that purpose. I have no more right to compromise with anybody, nor with myself. So that's with that in mind that we started Ritz-Carlton. We said, okay, now if we do that, what's the next step to understand what to our market and what is more sufficient? What is a more sufficient hotel to my market segment? We studied that. And we said, okay, if I am building a company that is more sufficient to my market than the competition is, and if I'm at the same time I'm more efficient, then I have a great company. But how am I going to be more sufficient? How am I going to take care of my market better than the competition? By understanding what my market wants, what makes them satisfied, by understanding it, truly understand it, and then create processes behind the expectation of the customer. So we set out and made studies, focus groups and other studies. And it was very clear, and then something exceptional happened. We found that whatever the customer buys, is it either a hotel stay, or by the way, a doctor's stay, or buying a car, or a television, or a house, or a bottle of water, the expectation subconsciously is the same. And understanding from behavioral analysts that fulfilling the subconscious is more important than fulfilling the conscious, I said, wow. Now that I know what you want, and I know what you want if you buy anything at all, if I'm supplying that more sufficiently, again, than the competition, I'm going to be the winner sooner or later. So what is it that the customer wants? What do you want? Let's stay with a bottle of water. If you bottle of water, what do you want? Subconsciously, you have three expectations. Number one, you want the product to be defect-free. That's an expectation. You don't want anything to swim in that bottle or whatever. You don't want the leak. Number two, you want it when you want it. Timeliness. And get it. Doctors, you need to know that, really. Come on. Timeliness is important, believe it or not. Obviously, you don't believe it. Timeliness is of extreme importance to people. No defect. Timeliness. And what else do you want when you buy that bottle of water? You want the people who give it to you be nice to you. Caring. Health care. My secretary, I'm honest, it's 2-3 days ago, my secretary was on the telephone, what happened? Well, I just told my primary care doctor, that I'm changing care doctor. I said, why don't you go, what happens? Why don't you want to go to your old doctor? Because he didn't care. That's true. No, I know that to be true. I happen to be a cancer survivor. I happen to have been before. My wife had cancer and so on. I dealt with doctors. Now, not you. There are two groups of people that are most difficult to teach and deal with: lawyers and doctors. It's a fact. Okay, I try to be very serious when I say that, but it's a fact. So what did we determine? That's what we have to create. We have to create no defect. We have to create processes behind this so that we work without defect and that we care. And then we analyze the caring piece, which is really service, caring service. We analyze that, what it is. How do we impact the guest and let the guest know that we care? So we established very clearly, and I work with behavioral analysts, I work with all kinds of people, we made surveys, I work with a word analyst who in focus groups didn't listen to what they said, but what words they used, what they meant really. So I could deal with facts. And the caring part was, we understood suddenly more and more that the caring part was the larger driver of customer satisfaction and eventually loyalty than anything else. Wow. So we implement. So we know service was important. So we had to define service. I worked in the service industry at that time about 40 years or something like that, 30 some, and nobody ever defined what service really is. We had to define it. So service starts, ladies and gentlemen, the instant we make contact. In fact, that instant is of utmost importance because it goes into the subconscious. So I want to establish with you, when you arrive in my hotel, the instant we make contact, looking you in the eyes and say good morning. Service is three steps: welcome, comply, farewell. So the first thing we do, welcome. It has to happen the first instant. So we learned that you and I, we make a decision when we meet somebody and come within 9 feet. This affects, by the way. When we come within 9 feet, we make a decision about each other, if we like it or not. It's a self-conscious thing. Oh, society tells you all this garbage. Oh, you shouldn't look this skin deep. Well, we can't help it. We're human beings. We make a decision. So what is a decision? So I make a decision to make you feel good the moment you make contact with me. And consequently, you are in a positive mode. In fact, we started this. Before we looked more scientifically on customer satisfaction, we had guest comment cards in the rooms. In fact, we had accumulated 400,000. And then I was told that it's not a scientific study. So I worked with J.D. Power and gave J.D. Power the 400,000 cards. They said, let's see, maybe we can see something. Here's what they came back with. Whenever, all the time, that means there was positive in the first four contacts, that means reservation or sales, doorman, front desk, and bellman, when that was positive, never ever did a complaint follow afterwards, because the guest was in a subconscious positive mode. Whenever there was one complaint, one negative, always other complaints followed. Wow. So we knew that first moment has to be perfect. So we taught, we knew if whatever happens, this has to happen, a great welcome. And then we comply to the guest's wishes. In the moment when the guests now have contact with us, it is not about me anymore. It's about you, the guest. How can I best help you? I'm here now. It's not about the company. It's not about me. It's about the customer. Complying to you, the customer. When that is over, we say farewell. Simple as that. So how am I going to accomplish that with my employees? Well, that's leadership. That's very simple leadership. How to accomplish that? I select people. And then I lead them, and then I invite them to be part of the philosophy, of the thinking, of the culture, of the dream of our company. Give them purpose. Now I have hired, now you're here, now you're joining me. Here, join me to create excellence. Join me to do this, not fulfill the function. But what do we do when we have, first of all, we hire rather than select. Select. I went to my concierge doctor. I don't know why the receptionist hates me, but she does. But then I thought, while sitting there, she hates everybody, so, you know. But wait a minute. She defines the doctor's office. She defines you, ladies and gentlemen. She defines who you are. Nobody goes away and says that the receptionist is rude. Everybody goes away and says they're rude in their office. So you have to select people and then align them to the thinking of your organization. The first day they come to work, that's called orientation. Impact them the first day, not the second day, it's too late. Because the first day, the behavioral analysts tell you, much of what they do, the friendliness, the warmth, the caring, all that, it's a behavior. Behavior cannot be taught unless there's a significant emotional event in a person's life. And the first day of work is a significant emotional event. That's when you teach them behavior. And then you teach them the function, of course. But you shouldn't even hire them for function. Here's the problem. We hired them for function. See, the chair on which you're sitting is fulfilling a function. But we're dealing with human beings. And as leaders, we know that. As leaders, we lead them to excellence. We lead them to what the vision that we have, that we know is of value to them. So we hired them. So we bring them the first day. We teach them, here's our heart. Here's our soul. Join us. Join us in our dreams. Join us in our... And here is... And if you give him the dream, of the vision of being the leader in the world, in our case. You have to give them the motive, why you want to do that, and connect your motive to theirs. So in our case, so we can grow, so you have opportunity, so we will be respected, so you will be respected, etc. Connect them the first day, welcome. It's the same, it's such to be the case, welcome the employees. Bring them in, align them, and then teach them the function. What happens in your businesses when the new employees, shall I tell you? Shall I tell you a secret? I know what happens in your businesses, because that happens in nearly all businesses. The new employee comes in, and the stupid team speech takes place. We're a team here. Blah, blah, blah. I mean, and what is a team? A team is a group of people who have a common objective. Oh, but that objective is not given. We're a team here. No, Bill, the new receptionist, or the Judy, the new receptionist, or whoever it is in your office. And in my case, the way that Bill, the way that comes in, the new one, we're a team here, Bill. Now, I want you to follow Joe. He knows the ropes. I thought this was a hotel. You're in the rope business? He knows the ropes. So Bill works with Joe. And on the way to the kitchen, Joe tells Bill, this company sucks. That's his orientation. That's his orientation. Come on, it's happening all around us. And then we have expectation of him. What kind of a leadership is I'm? Nobody talks to our new employees the first couple of days, but top management in the new hotels, I did. Here's who we are. Here's our heart. Here's our soul. Join me, and here's the value of it. Here's the motive. Here's what we're going to, here's how you're going to be successful with us. And you know, I made a speech one and a half years ago with all the five-star managers from around the world came there, Forbes function every year, and I was invited, and the Forbes guy gets up and said, Horst Schulz is in the room. Mind you, they're all hotel people. They all got up and applauded. Did they applaud me? No. They applauded the image that Ritz-Carlton had. But you know, I benefit from it, but what about my employees? I can tell you unequivocally, if a Ritz-Carlton employee looks for a job still today, 100 others, the Ritz-Carlton employee gets it. Because of the image that we created together. We are together creating an image of our organization, and the image is going to make you successful. And that employee establishes that receptionist, that person, that employee that deals with the customer, establish the image that you have. And that is why we concentrate on selecting them, concentrate on orienting them. What did we do next? We established the 20 things that we knew. If we do those 20 things superior to the competition, we will be the world's leader. So we taught those 20 things the second day of work. And then we took one of those steps, one of the 20 steps, and repeated them every day. Every day we repeated one step. Today, it may be step 11. That is being repeated in every hotel around the world. To satisfy this customer. In fact, you are empowered, in our case, believe it or not, every employee was empowered up to $2,000 not to lose this customer. That means if you're the waiter in the morning and the guest comes down and the waiter says, how was your stay? And he says, it was not so good, my toilet didn't flush. Forgive me, I feel so bad, I will buy you breakfast. So he moves now a disgruntled customer to a loyal customer. You see, you have three types of customers. Satisfied ones. They become terrorists against you. They talk negative about you. Then they're the satisfied ones. If they see a better deal or somebody else is recommended, that's where they're going to go. Or then they're the loyal ones that have developed trust in you. Loyalty is nothing but trust. If they're dissatisfied, in a way, so are your employees. They're dissatisfied. They're terrorists against you. Then they're dissatisfied. They're okay. But if they get an offer for 5 cents more, organization, and that's what it's all about. You have to give them purpose and make them feel part, and that is satisfaction in the human beings, and that is what leadership accomplished, to make the one that has to, that is accomplished by managers. The ones that, the employees that want to do the job, that's accomplished by leaders, by showing them a purpose in life, by connecting them to the purpose, by connecting them to the motives of the purpose, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And by the way, this is not only the right thing to do. Good luck with it, and thank you very much.